over to you and we can see your presentation.
Okay.
So before you start, yeah. So this talk is again about data flow analysis of asynchronous system using abstract domains. So over to you, Sneha.
Okay. Hello. Good morning, all. I'm Snigdha. I'll be presenting my work on our work on data flow analysis of asynchronous systems using infinite abstract domains. This work was done in collaboration with K.V. Raghavan and K. Narayan Kumar from CMI while my time at IISc Bangalore. The slides are not moving. Let me. What is wrong?
I think there is some window on top of your slide, which is
That's the WebEx thing.
Okay, so probably that is taking the focus.
I guess. Yeah.
Are you in presentation mode, Snigdha?
Yes, I am in presentation mode.
Try to click the mouse instead of using the arrows.
And now it's working.
Okay.
And also your sound, there's a bit of a noise kind of thing. I don't know if you can do anything about it.
Okay. Is this better?
It's kind of a little high frequency.
Sorry. Is this better?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Okay. So, yeah. Sorry for all the technical disturbances. So, okay. Let me restart. So we know that distributed systems are everywhere and we are all familiar with distributed systems. They usually have multiple processes that execute in a parallel and independent manner. And these processes can also communicate with each other. Asynchronous message passing systems are a subclass of distributed systems where the inter-process communication is using channels. And the execution depends on the occurrences of events such as sending and receiving of a message. So now let's look at these asynchronous systems in a little more detail. So here we have a system with two processes, process one and process two. Additionally, we have a FIFO channel C1 and messages M1 and M2 that you can send to and receive from C1. Process one also can access a variable X and update its value. So we use this band notation to represent the sending of a message M1, and we use the question mark notation to represent the receiving of a message from the head of a channel. So receive here is a blocking operation. That is, the process will not make progress unless message M1 is present at the head of channel C1. What we would now like to do is to analyze such systems, that is asynchronous message passing systems. But what happens is, the presence of queues or channels makes most of the properties undecidable. Hence, what we need to do is to abstract such a system so that some interesting properties become decidable. So what we use to abstract is the unordered channel abstraction, where all the channels are abstracted using counters. Under this abstraction, each channel comma message pair is associated with a counter. So here we have two pairs, C1 M1 and C1 M2. And therefore, we have two counters, the first and the second counter for the two pairs respectively. The send operation is modeled as the increment of the corresponding corresponding counter. So here we send a message M1 to channel C1. So here the counter corresponding to M1 is incremented, whereas the counter corresponding to M2 is not affected at all. Similarly, the receive operation is modeled as a decrement of the corresponding counter. Now let's look at the semantics under this abstraction and let's compare them to the original semantics of the original asynchronous system. So the six systems execute in parallel and hence the execution begins in the initial states of both the processes, that is A, C. We have the initial value of the variable X equals to 0 and the initial channel, which is empty. So this is the abstraction of the empty channel. Now let's say in the initial channel configuration, the second process tries to make progress and tries to receive message. So this is the receiving of a message M1 from the channel. And of course, from the empty channel, you cannot receive a message. So this is an invalid move in the original system. So in this system, what you get is a negative configuration in the channel. And this negative configuration is an infeasible state under this abstraction. Now, let's look at another possibility of an execution. So let's say this is an intermediate configuration in your system. This is an abstraction of the concrete configuration where the value of X is 1 And in the channel, M2 is followed by M1. That is, M2 is at the head of the channel, and this is the abstract configuration of that concrete configuration. Now, let's say under this, the second process tries to make progress and results in this resultant configuration. This move would have been invalid in the original system, whereas here it is a perfectly feasible state. So now this is the effect of the abstraction that we have used. So therefore, some infeasible traces will be included due to abstraction, but this is a pretty popular abstraction in the literature, and then therefore we will just go with it. So now I come to the VCFG, or the vast control flow graph, which is the central data structure of our algorithm. So on the left hand side, you see the abstracted asynchronous system, that is the one with unordered channels. And VCFG is nothing but a product graph. So the nodes in the VCFG are the product of the nodes in the original asynchronous system. The edges are also the product of the original edges. That means that if there is an edge in the original system from A to B, there will be an edge from A comma C to B comma C. The edges are annotated with a pair, that is an action comma vector, where action represents the effect to the memory or the variables, and vector represents the effect on the channels or the counters. So in this case, the edge from A to B was a send message and was an increment to the first counter. Similarly, the edge from A comma C to B comma C has the action ID, that is, it does not affect the variable at all, and increments the first counter. Similarly, there will be an edge from B comma C to A comma C because of this edge from B to A that updates the value of X. The action would be the update to X, and the channel contents will not be affected. So these edges are added in a similar manner, and this VCFG will be the central data structure of our algorithm. The concept of feasible and infeasible paths also transfers to the VCFG because of the abstraction. So here is a feasible path. In general, for a feasible path, all the prefixes should have non-negative configurations. And all the infeasible paths, there would be at least one prefix that will have a negative configuration. So we will have infeasible and feasible paths in the VCFG. Now, the analysis that we have in mind for the asynchronous systems is a data flow analysis. So I'll just introduce it a little. So data flow analysis, the objective is to approximate the values of each of the variables, or approximate the state at different points in the program. The analysis takes as input, first of all, a CFG, or a control flow graph. It also takes as input a complete lattice L and abstracts the value of all the variables using that lattice L. It also associates transfer functions, L to L transfer functions, with each of the edges in the CFG. And hence, each path in the system is also associated with the transfer function, where the path transfer function is nothing but the composition of individual edge transfer functions. Finally, what data flow analysis does is transforms the initial values via these path transfer functions to different points in the program, and over approximates those values by using the lattice join function and computing the join at different points in the program. This is known as, or this is also known as, join over all paths, or the JOP analysis. JOP analysis, and that is what we would like to do over the VCFG. Now, in the context of a VCFG, what may happen is that some paths may be infeasible because of the criteria that we discussed previously. So, for example, let's say this path is infeasible, and therefore the values that are being joined at different locations, you need to be only due to feasible paths, and therefore this value should not show up in the final solution. That is, we just need to compute the join over all feasible path solutions and not a blind join over all path solution. So that brings us to the final problem statement that we address. That is, we are given VCFG, we are given an infinite or finite abstract domain L. We are given an initial value, and we are given a node in mind. And what we want to do is to compute the precise join over all feasible paths for that target node, and where the JOFP is given using this formula. Under this problem statement, we make the following contributions. First of all, we propose a sound and precise backward DFS solution, a backward DFS algorithm which admits a class of infinite abstract domain. This algorithm computes the precise JOFP. We also propose a forward DFS algorithm which is more general and admits a broader class of abstract domains. It in general computes a conservative over approximation of the JOFP. And both algorithms use the same abstraction, that is the unordered channel abstraction. In this presentation, we'll be discussing only the backward DFAs, as it is a conceptually a little more interesting than forward DFAs. So before discussing the algorithm, I'll come to the illustrative example. This is a VCFG. In this VCFG, I'll just go it bit by bit. So we have four variables, T, X, Y, and Z. We have a single channel comma message pair or a single counter. There's a first loop which updates the variables and sends a message when the loop is iterated. The second loop only receives a message, and then we have the final node. So now what we would like to know in this system is which variables are constant at this particular node K. To do that, let's do it a little informally and explore paths. We'll just explore paths and see what actual values reach K. Let's consider this path that does not traverse through the first loop but enters the second loop and reaches K. Now this path will have the variable values 0 for all the variables, but the channel contents would be negative. So this is a negative state and hence an infeasible path. So this would not be part of the JOFP and it's not feasible at all. So we'll discard this. Now let's consider a path that takes two iterations of the first loop and then enters the second loop. So the channel contents at the end of this path are 0, which is totally feasible, and the variable values that are reached are 1 and 1 for T and Z and 2 and 1 for X and Y respectively. So this is the first set of feasible values that reach K actually. Now let's look at another path which iterates the first loop thrice and then enters the second loop. The channel contents are 1, which is also feasible, and the variable values that reach at this point are as shown here. Now if we notice, the values of variables T and Z have not changed. As it turns out, the values of variables T and Z will not change at all, no matter how many times you iterate the first loop, whereas the values of X and Y will keep on incrementing with every iteration of the loop. So informally, we can claim that T and Z are constants and X and Y are not constants, and that is what we would like the analysis to infer. But the problem is that this loop can be iterated any number of times. So it's arbitrarily high number of times, making the counter value go up to arbitrarily high values. And therefore, exploring all paths and all counter configurations to detect constants is just not possible. So we need to do something smarter and to explore paths in a better way so that the algorithm terminates. So that's what brings me to the backward DFAS algorithm. The central concept in this algorithm is the demand of a path. The demand of a path is the definition is that it is the minimum channel contents at the beginning of the path such that the ending value is greater than or equal to 0. So what we want is that we want the value of the channel contents at this point to be greater than or equal to 0. And therefore, let's consider this suffix. This suffix does not affect the channel contents at all. So therefore, you can begin with a 0 and end with a 0 here. Right? Here, though, what we have is that we have a receive operation here, and then we have the rest of the path. So we need to begin with at least one message in the queue, or at least the value of 1 as the counter, so that we can reach the end of this path with a value greater than or equal to 0. Similarly, here we need to have at least 2 messages in the queue, or the demand of 2, to clear all of this and to reach here with a value greater than or equal to 0. But when we encounter a send operation, the send operation is able to fulfill one of the receive operations or one of the negatives. And therefore, the demand here decreases, and therefore we can only start with a least value of 1, and we would still cross the suffix here and end with the value of greater than or equal to 0 at the end of this path. So this is the concept of a demand of a path, and therefore the demand of this path is 2. Keeping that in mind, I'll start discussing the algorithm. So the algorithm is a backward traversal of the graph. So we have the target node in mind, and we traverse the edges in the backward direction. So at one edge at a time. So the first path explored is the path JK, path suffix JK here. The demand of this path, demand of this P, path extension P is 1, and the path transfer function is ID. These are the details that the algorithm records about the explorations. So path transfer function ID means that the value of the variable is not affected. Demand means that you need to clear at least one receive operations as you move forward along this extension. As we go in the backward direction, I'm showing you extensions in longer chunks. So we go backwards and explore in this direction. So we have this path CHIJK, and the demand of this path is 3 due to these 3 receive operations. The value of the variable X is not affected. Well, the values of the variables are not affected along this suffix as well. Now let's look at this interesting path, which goes in the backward direction along this second loop. So it's JKHIJK. The demand of this path suffix is equal to 4 because of the 4 receive operations the path sees. The path transfer function is still ID. Now, if you notice, this path has the same endpoints as this path. So the path that is already present is an entry with a lower demand. And also, the transfer function did not change. So the algorithm deduces or infers that this path is covered or not useful. That is, exploring this path even further will not give us any more different values. So what the algorithm does is discards this particular path and does not explore this further. So what it does is it goes ahead and explores the CHIJK path further and stops the exploration of the second loop at this point itself. Now, when CHIJK is explored in the backward direction, that is this path here, we see the update of variables. So hence the path's transfer function changes. So this is the LCP. This is the LCP transfer function. That is this is just the transfer function actually. So the value of, for example, the value of the, this is the next state, previous state notation, where it says that the new value of X at the end of the path is equal to the initial value of X plus 1. And all the other functions are defined in a similar way. The demand of this path is 2. So now what the algorithm keeps on doing is it keeps increasing the iterations of the path. So this is the path that we explored initially, and this is the path with an iteration increase, and so on. The demand of the paths keeps on decreasing, and it cannot decrease beyond 0 because beyond 0, it's just extra send operations that you have. So demand does not record that. And these are the corresponding transfer functions. So after one iteration, the value is incremented by 1. After 2 iterations, it's incremented by 2, the value of X, and so on. So now, after iterations, the algorithm reaches this point and explores and iterates the first loop 5 times. If now we observe, we have paths which begin and end at the same points as this path, which are of lower demand. And also the join of these paths, I hope you guys are able to see this, but when you join the transfer functions of these two paths, that dominates using the lattice theory domination operation, it dominates the transfer function of this path. And hence the algorithm infers that this path here, this iteration, the path that has 5 iterations is already covered. And therefore it discards it, and the exploration in this direction stops. That is, no more iterations of this loop are explored. So now the only direction of exploration is in this direction towards the start node. And therefore all these extensions are extended along this direction, reaching the start node, and therefore now we obtain these set of paths where the algorithm again deduces that this last path is again useless, and therefore it returns the path finally that starts at the start node, end at the node in question, and have 0 demand. So that is the termination condition. That is the result that the algorithm returns, and it stops exploration because there's no more incoming edges to explore. This is the final solution. Now, if we look at the transfer functions of the final solution, we can see that the T and Z are constants, whereas X and Y are non-constants, and that is the answer we wanted to obtain. So that is how the backward, the DFAS algorithm works. I'll now discuss a little implementation and experimental evaluation details. So we have implemented both the backward and forward DFAS algorithms. We have used 14 benchmarks from different sources, and it's a highly parallel prototype to handle the complexity of the algorithm. So in the experimental setup, what we have, let's say N1 and N2 are the two nodes in the VCFG connected by an edge that updates the value of X using the value of Y, that is X equals to Y plus 1. In this case, what we call Y is the use, that is this reference to Y here is called a use at node N1. And the objective of the experiment is to find whether the use of Y is a constant at N1. This is a popular constant propagation analysis, and CP is the most popular abstract domain for detecting constants. And that's what we use to instantiate our algorithms with. So CP is an infinite abstract domain. So forward DFS admits that, and therefore it is instantiated with CP. Backward DFS does not admit CP itself, but it admits a slightly less precise variant of CP, that is linear constant propagation. But the reason being that it has a finite height transfer function lattice, unlike CP, which has an infinite height transfer function lattice. We also have two baselines. One is the naive JOP or join over all paths that ignores all Q operations. That is also instantiated with the most powerful CP analysis. And then we have the state of the art, the baseline representing the state of the art, which is the JOFP. JOFP means the precise analysis using copy constant propagation. Now, CCP or copy constant propagation is an even weaker variant of LCP. It only has a finite abstract domain, but it represents a closely related work that computes the JOFP, which only admit finite domains. So that is what the baseline here represents. So I'll come to the results. First of all, how many uses were identified as constants? So here are the numbers. Clearly from the numbers, we can see that both forward DFS and backward DFS outperform both the baselines. Forward DFS finds 2.9x more constants than JOP, that is the naive baseline, and 62% more than CCP, that is the state of the art. We have backward DFS that finds 2.2x more constants than JOP and 26% more than CCP. In summary, it may look like that forward DFS is more precise, but backward DFS infers more constants in two benchmarks. So they are incomparable and not a subset or superset of each other. What we also did was we used the inferred constants to verify assertions present in the benchmarks. So we had a total of 42 assertions. And in assertions, both forward and backward DFS verify almost 5 times the assertions verified by the JOP. They also outperform CCP by identifying 57% and 43% more assertions respectively in forward DFS and backward DFS. So there also they outperform the CCP baseline. In terms of execution time, what we did was we measured the execution time slowdown with respect to the naive baseline. So as we can see, JOP is always fast because it does not take care of the infeasible paths. But it looks like that forward DFS is the fastest in general, but it has scalability issues in case of some benchmarks, and it did not terminate for two benchmarks. So when it finishes fast, but there are times when it does not finish at all. Backward DFS and the JOFP baseline, the CCP JOFP baseline, they seem slower, but one should remember that both of them are demand-driven algorithms, and therefore the results that we are reporting here are cumulative across all users, and hence the slowdown seems more apparent than it actually is. But the good thing is that the CCP and backward are quite comparable. One should remember that CCP is a finite data domain, whereas backward DFS admits infinite domains. Some pointers for the future work: what we would like to do is to extend backward DFS to admit any infinite domain, also improve the scalability of forward DFS, explore approaches like POR. We want to handle parameters and functions calls in a more general way, and to, of course, run the algorithm on real world async programs and see how it performs there. These are some of the listed related works. The common theme across them is they admit only finite abstract domains, but they have different techniques to do data flow analysis or verification. So in conclusion, I would just like to say that we have proposed two approaches for interprocedural data flow analysis of asynchronous systems using infinite abstract domains. We have a backward DFS algorithm that computes a precise JOFP solution but admits a slightly lower class, slightly restricted class of infinite abstract domains. We have proposed a more general forward DFS algorithm that is sound in general, but it admits almost every infinite domain. We have implemented the algorithms as tool and compared them against 14 benchmarks with encouraging results. That's all from my side.
Thank you, Sigda. And we have some 7 minutes for Q&A. So if you have any question, you can raise hand or unmute yourself or type on chat. Sridhar, can you go back to the slide on LCP and CP, the first slide where you refer to them?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, this one.
Yes, this one. So, what do you mean by finite height transfer? Oh, so are you saying the lattice is of finite height or transfer function is of finite height? So,
the
this sentence.
The lattice of transfer functions is of finite height. The lattice is also a finite height, but it's still infinite. But that does not guarantee that the lattice of transfer functions will also be finite height. In case of LCP, that is the case, that it's finite height and infinite lattice, and the transfer function also has those properties. Yeah.
Okay. So the second thing you talked about, your implementation did not terminate on a couple of benchmarks.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but theoretically, does your algorithm terminate?
Theoretically, it terminates. So it's a, I think it's a double exponential complexity because of the presence of channels and the abstraction, the way it is presented. So we have also computed the complexity of the intra-procedural algorithm, and that is of double exponential nature because of the, I mean, anything in the domain of, you know, petty nets or unordered channels or anything that goes there. And this, and forward DFAs is also a whole program analysis. So it hits memory issues. That's the main concern there.
So what was the timeout that you kept for your experiment?
Yeah, I think 5 hours is what we kept. Otherwise, everything finished in, I mean, if I go to the execution time, it's even backward.
Right, a few seconds.
300 seconds, yeah, odd seconds, yeah. So 5 hours, we let it run for more, but 5 hours is the timeout that we had.
Okay. So, any other question? I see RD, please go ahead. I see your hand raised. And Raghavan has put some comment, I'll just check.
Yeah. So Snigdha, just one question. And it may seem a little naive because I think I joined a little late. I saw that you gave an example of computing constants at a given node. And yes. I was just wondering that instead of constants, if I'm looking for something else, let's say reaching definitions or any other data flow problem that I'm interested in. I was just wondering whether there is any commonality that I can extract, or I have to, you know, kind of sort of rewrite the whole algorithm for the different problem that I'm interested in.
No, you would not have to rewrite. So reaching definitions is just another lattice, right? I mean, different set of transfer functions. It's just another framework. So what we have done is, it's not specific to CP. What we have done is instantiated the algorithm to CP. So it has a plug and play feature. We just need an input as a lattice. We do not depend on the lattice per se. We depend on the lattice properties, the general algebraic lattice properties, like the normal abstract interpretation does.
Okay, so I could just specify my lattice for the problem that I am interested in, and I could still use the same implementation.
Yes.
That.
So already for the backward DFAs, actually one has to provide the lattice of transfer functions. Along with the composition and join operation on transfer functions. So it's a little bit more complicated, but it's still, the tool is still a generic framework once you provide the lattice. Whereas for the forward DFAs, you provide the normal lattice of values.
Oh, okay. So you're saying that the details of lattices required for a forward and backward problem could be different, but by and large, I could reuse the framework.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. So another question can I ask, Amir?
Sorry, go ahead. Somehow I got
unmuted. Okay. Yeah. So this is more general, and again, maybe because I missed something. So you mentioned, Snigdha, that the forward DFAs is a slightly broader class of abstract domains. So
yes.
can you elaborate that a little bit, because I missed out on.
Yeah, so backward DFAs has this assumption that the domain that it can admit should have a finite height of the transfer function lattice.
Okay.
That is a restriction of the backward DFAs because of the way it is designed. So it admits lattices like ARA and LCP, but it cannot admit, let's say, something like CP. very readily.
Okay.
Power DFS, on the other hand, is almost similar to the normal data flow analysis with a little tricks built in. It sounds, but let not the word trick misguide you. But what it can handle things like widening and all, and hence it can admit a lot more data domains than backward DFS.
I see. And so the backward DFS, you mentioned that it's part of the future work that maybe that can also be extended, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
So Snigdha, can you please stop presenting? And I request Tanmay to start presenting his slide. Once Snigdha stops. So our next speaker today is Tanmay Mahapatra from BITS Pilani. And he will talk about his work on high-level graphical programming for big data systems.
Stop sharing.
Yeah, there are so many different video platforms these days that you have to discover. So let me see if I can stop. So Tanmay can Tanmay start. So
okay, sorry.
Yeah, up to you. It's a handover to you, Tanmay. Please go ahead.
Yeah,
Tanmay, please hold on for a minute. I will stop the current video and then start again.
Yes.